Bestsell, an imprint of Octopus Publishing Group Limited, presents Being Your Cat, Inside Your Feline's Mind, written by Celia Haddon with Dr. Daniel Mills, FRCVS, and read by Joan Walker. Introduction. What is it like to be your cat? What is it like to see the world through your cat's eyes, hear the world through feline ears, smell the world through your cat's nose, taste food the way it tastes to your cat, and feel the world through your cat's whiskers? It's a very different world from the human world. Different types of animals, different species live in different worlds. Indeed, each species has its own senses and biases in its brain and experiences the world according to what is important for its survival. No creature can experience all reality. The brain leaves out what is not necessary for the lifestyle of each animal, either blanking it out completely or blurring it, as it were, into the background. The brain also groups other things together according to what is important to it. For example, all those things that are to be avoided. But what makes up that category varies from one species to another. We all live in our own realities, allowing us to focus on what matters and discarding the rest. This applies as much to humans as it does to cats. To understand your cat, therefore, you need to know the basis of the world that it lives in, because a cat's world is so different from your world. And for that, you need a guidebook, this book, to get a better understanding of the feline world. Humans live in a world with a concave blue sky, the sight of hills in the distance miles away in the landscape, and the faint smell of the roses in the garden. Younger individuals with good hearing may just be able to detect the cry of a bat on a summer evening. The landscape that the cat sees and the soundscape that the cat hears are very different. The human smellscape and the feline smellscape are, as one might say, worlds apart. Many of the odors in the world do not register strongly in the human brain at all. The smell of a mouse dropping left 12 hours ago, for example, or the odour of next door's dog lifting its leg on the front doorstep, or the curious plastic smell given off by an electric plug heating up. These scents belong to the world of the cat, where they are very significant. Conversely, the cat world has no bright blue sky or accurate distant landscapes. These are blurred out. Your cat's Umwelt. There's a word for these different realities, Umwelt. Translated literally from the German, this means environment. But ethologists, those who study the natural behavior of animals, use it to describe the world as it is experienced by a particular living organism, the self-world of an animal. The writer who first used the word in this particular sense was Professor Jakob Johann von Exkull, 1864 to 1944. A Baltic German aristocrat whose family lost their fortune in the 1917 Russian Revolution. To support himself, he became an academic biologist. His theory of Umwelt can be summed up this way. All animals, from the simplest to the most complex, are fitted into their unique worlds with equal completeness. The example he gave was the world of the tick. Ticks are tiny, eight-legged creatures related to spiders that attach themselves to animals to suck their blood. They look like a small round bag with legs and a beak at the front. Hikers with bare legs may find a tick on their leg, and if they're unwise enough to squash it, the tick will not only empty out the bag of blood all over their fingers, but leave behind its mouth parts, which can carry the nasty bacterium that causes Lyme disease. So what is the world, the Umwelt, of this tick? Von Exkull described the simple life cycle of the tick. A female tick climbs upwards to the tip of a twig or a blade of grass. She climbs upwards, not downwards, towards the light that she senses through her skin. Then if she detects the odour of a warm-blooded animal, the smell of butyric acid which exudes from the skin glands of all mammals, she hurls herself towards it. If she lands on the prey, she knows she's in the right place because the animal is warm. If she misses the animal and lands on the cold ground, she has to start to climb again. Once on the animal, she wriggles through the fur till she finds a hairless bit of skin, then sticks her mouth through the skin to suck the warm blood. Full of blood, she falls to the ground, lays her eggs, and dies. As von Exkull pointed out, experiments have proved that the tick lacks all sense of taste. Once the membrane is perforated, she will drink any fluid of the right temperature. The world of a tick, her Umwelt, is therefore a simple but effective one. To survive, a tick does not need to see well, feel much or smell much, just the things that help her survive. The smell of a rose or wet grass is not part of her world. There is no bright blue canopy of the sky for the tick. She has no sense of taste because she doesn't need one. The noise of the passing animal onto which she will drop is silent for her because she has no hearing. In her world, there are only a few things that she perceives or needs to perceive. The light towards which she climbs on the blade of grass, the odour of the passing animal, the tactile sensation as she lands on then burrows through the hair of a furry animal, and the warmth of the blood which is her meal. Only these stimuli have what Jacob von Exkull described as a special biological meaning for her. He added, "The whole rich world around the tick shrinks and changes into a scanty framework, her Umwelt. But the very poverty of this world guarantees the unfailing certainty of her actions. Cats are not ticks, although ticks sometimes fall on them. There is more, much more in their world, but it is a different world from that of a human." Walking in your cat's paws. Can we really put ourselves into our cat's world? Walk through the house in their paws, see with their eyes, hear with those feline ears. Philosophers and biologists have debated whether we can ever get into the mind of another person, let alone a cat. Do we even know what our human partner or our child is thinking? Of course, we can ask them, and if they answer truthfully, we can get some idea. But maybe even then, what they tell us and how they describe their thoughts and feelings will only convey to us what we personally are able to imagine, not the full reality of their inner world, as they experience it, but only our version of it. We can never feel the exact feelings or think the exact thoughts of another human being, any more than we can completely feel their bodily feelings of pain if they fall over on a concrete pavement. We can imagine what those feelings and thoughts might be like, and then with empathy feel what we would feel if we were in their place. Even so, this will never be exactly what another human experiences. We can imagine the pain of that fall on concrete, but only as we would feel it, not as they feel it. Other minds are never wholly open to us. So how on earth can we know what it is like to be one of our cats? Is it even possible? The American philosopher Thomas Nagel, born in 1937, wrote a famous essay, "What is it like to be a bat?" in which he grappled with the difficulty of what it is like to try to be in another being's mind, in particular in an animal's mind. Conscious experience occurs at many levels of animal life, though we cannot be sure of its presence in the simpler organisms, and it is very difficult to say in general what provides evidence of it. The fact that an organism has conscious experience at all means, basically, that there is something it is like to be that organism. He chose to write about bats because they are warm-blooded animals like ourselves, but the way they see their world through echolocation, a bit like radar, and the life they lead are so very different from humans. As he declared, bat sonar, though clearly a form of perception, is not similar in its operation to any sense that we possess, and there's no reason to suppose that it is subjectively like anything we can experience. He concluded that we cannot even imagine what it would be like to have bat sonar. And even if we could imagine ourselves flying around in the dark, catching insects with the help of high-frequency sound signals, or hanging upside down to sleep, it would only tell us what it would be like for a human to do that. This is what some blind individuals have learned when they use echoes to help them navigate environments. However, using their experience as an equivalent to that of a bat is still anthropomorphic. that is, attributing human experience to a non-human animal. The world of the bat remains essentially closed to us, Nagel declared, no matter how well we research its life. Indeed, he claimed that science itself cannot help us with some parts of reality, such as the inner experience of a bat. So where does this leave you if you want to understand fully the life of your cat? Should you just learn the biological and behavioral facts and leave it at that? Is anything other than hard facts, the results of scientific endeavor, dangerously anthropomorphic? Should we cat lovers give up trying to imagine what it is like to be a cat? Most scientists studying animal behavior are, rightly, wedded to the idea that the simplest explanation for any animal behavior should usually be chosen over a more complex one. This is known as Morgan's canon, after the psychologist Conway Lloyd Morgan, 1852-1936. It says, in no case is an animal activity to be interpreted as the outcome of the exercise of a higher psychical faculty, if it can be fairly interpreted as the outcome of the exercise of one which stands lower in the psychological scale. But of course, as Thomas Nagel pointed out, this is just a rule of thumb, because the complete experience of the inner life of an animal remains hidden from us anyway, hidden even from the most dedicated researcher. Some scientists, anxious to stick to what can be observed and proved, have gone even further. They have claimed that while they see and measure animal and human behavior, what is going on inside the animal is just impossible to know. It is either not worth knowing or simply is not there. The great American behaviorist B.F. Skinner, 1904-1990, studied how animals learn behavior, working in his laboratory mostly with rats and pigeons, rather than cats. He could measure what they did, but he could not and did not try to see or measure how they felt while they were doing it. He would train a rat to press a lever, for instance, and reward it for doing so with some food. The rat quickly learned that the consequence of pressing the lever resulted in the reward, and therefore repeated its behavior. Skinner is one of the fathers of learning theory, and his findings have influenced all animal trainers who train with rewards, even if they do not know the theory behind their skill in training. What might have been going on inside the brain of one of Skinner's rats? Did the rat feel pleasurable desire in the anticipation of getting the food? Was that pleasurable desire in its brain the reason why it pressed the lever? Did it feel frustration if the reward was not forthcoming, which in turn motivated it to try harder? Such questions were not for B.F. Skinner. He declared, "The emotions are excellent examples of the fictional causes to which we commonly attribute behavior." Just because he could strip something down to simple, visible behavior associations in the lab did not mean it was a simple process in the rat's brain. Though Skinner might be horrified by the very idea, these brain processes include consciousness, that is, how the world is experienced. Do animals have an inner life? The view that animals may not have inner lives has a long history. It goes back to the 17th century when some philosophers and scientists believed that animals were merely like machines as they had no souls. An extreme version of this standpoint was taken by the French rationalist and priest Nicolas Malebranche, 1638-1715, who wrote, "In dogs, cats, and other animals, there is neither intelligence nor a spiritual soul in the usual sense. They eat without pleasure. They cry without pain. They believe without knowing it. They desire nothing. They know nothing. And if they act in what seems to be an intelligent and purposive manner, it is only because God has made them fit to survive and has constructed their bodies in such a way that they can organically avoid, without knowing that they do so, everything that might destroy them and that they seem to fear." Nowadays, there are very few biologists who would go so far as Malebranche or even agree with Skinner. Neuroscience has changed everything. We can now look at the workings inside the brain and see emotional networks in action. In July 2012, a group of cognitive neuroscientists declared, "The weight of evidence indicates that humans are not unique in possessing the neurological substrates that generate consciousness. Non-human animals, including all mammals and birds, and many other creatures, including octopuses, also possess these neurological substrates." This declaration says that animals have some kind of consciousness, and it would be harder today to find a biologist who claims that our cats have no inner lives, that they are simply furry automata. Even so, we must accept that we cannot ever fully put ourselves into our cat's experience of life. If so, is there any point in at least trying to imagine what it is like to be a cat? Does it matter if we're being anthropomorphic in doing this? Concern for animal welfare is why we should do it. Fellow feeling, a form of anthropomorphism, promotes animal welfare. It helps us better care for animals. If we believe animals are just machines without feelings, we will feel free to cause them pain. If we believe they, like us, can suffer pain and have rich emotional lives, we will treat them better. If we can imaginatively put ourselves into the world of a cat, using the information that science has given us, we can appreciate how things that might be irrelevant or harmless to us might have real meaning to them, and so better understand how we can give our cats a better life. Sadly, a lot of suffering occurs when people do not make the additional step of trying to put themselves in the experiential world of another, but merely ask how they would feel as a human in that situation. Honest empathy motivates kindness. A study of psychology students showed that when they read a text in which dogs were described in anthropomorphic language, they were more ready to help dogs than when they had read a text describing dogs in non-anthropomorphic language. Strange? Not really. Most of us pet owners talk to our cats and dogs as if they were human listeners and feel they are part of the family. These anthropomorphic feelings are at least part of the reason why most of us would be horrified if our loved pet animal were served up as Sunday dinner. We humans have many characteristics in common with cats and other mammals. We have the same warm-blooded body with similar organs. We have brains that follow a similar broad structure, even if some parts are relatively bigger in one species than the other. Even though we do not know for sure, most neuroscientists also think that our cats, like other mammals, have the capacity to feel emotions that, in some ways at least, are similar to human emotions. Anthropomorphism, of course, can go too far when we think other animals have the same priorities and desires for luxuries that we might have. Think of people who you sometimes see in a town street pushing their dog in a pram as if it were a human baby, not because it has mobility problems. That dog would probably much prefer to be down at pavement level, using its nose to scent out urine marks from other dogs and cocking its leg to add its mark to those on the lamppost. Or take a look at cats dressed up as human characters on the internet. Most do not look happy. A more subtle form of anthropomorphic failure is to feed cats from bowls lined up close to each other. This looks cute to us humans, who sit down to have a meal together as a social event, but is often stressful for the cats. We humans will eat and drink in a line at a bar and enjoy the sociability that goes with this. Cats are generally not sociable in their eating habits. They usually prefer to eat alone. Almost certainly, at least some of the cats in the line will be anxious at having to eat so close to another cat. These are the mistakes of anthropomorphism arising from our love and emotional engagement with cats. They often occur out of good intention, but also out of ignorance. Knowledge helps us avoid these mistakes. Using science to test ideas and try to understand the world from that animal's perspective and the environment it has adapted to live in is an example of what is known as critical anthropomorphism and is an important skill for researchers and owners alike. We can use our imagination to light up knowledge and create the empathy that motivates us to do the best we can for our animals. For example, all of us know that domestic cats are much smaller than human beings. That is obvious even to the human who dislikes felines. Yet how many of us have thought through the implication of being a small animal? What does being small mean in a world inhabited by much larger animals, some of them hostile to cats? How does a cat feel when a gigantically heavy human hugs it tight against their giant chest? If we use our imagination, we should be able to see that for many cats, this could be a frightening rather than a pleasant experience. That may encourage us to express our affection in a more acceptable form if we really care about cats. If we fuse imagination with knowledge, using the available science and an honest approach to empathy to understand them, we will get a much better understanding of the feline Umwelt. However, we must be humble and admit that we will still make some mistakes. Nonetheless, this all helps us to practice a more thoughtful and kindlier care for our cats. Put yourself in the place of your cat and enter its Umwelt, its secret world. Chapter 1. What is it like being in your feline body? When you first inhabit your feline body, you notice a strange sensation. You can feel fur under your chin and cheek and all over your body. If you're curled up and resting, your face will be positioned on your tail, which is also furry. Your tail is curved round over your back legs, forming a cozy cushion for your head. This is the first experience of your new feline body, covered with fur and with an entirely new appendage, the tail. Then you stretch. Humans who do yoga or Pilates stretch this way deliberately, but you just do it automatically. Your back rides high up and your four legs stiffen. Four of them. Then you lean forwards to stretch the back legs. The stretch flows through you in a delicious way without you having to think about what you're doing or what you need to do next. Your whole body has a kind of effortless grace. You realize you have no hands. Just legs. This is the second experience of your new feline body. On four legs. Four legs make a huge difference. The template for a mammal, whether a human or a cat, is more or less the same body framework, with an approximately similar skeleton, but in each species the design is modified to fit what the individual species needs in its environment. As the famous naturalist Charles Darwin, 1809 to 1892, wrote, "What can be more curious than that the hand of a man, formed for grasping, that of a mole for digging, the leg of a horse, the paddle of the porpoise, and the wing of the bat, should all be constructed on the same pattern?" This similar pattern, modified to each species, applies to both the human and the cat. If you are a cat, this framework is mainly horizontal rather than vertical. This horizontal skeletal pattern, common to many animals, changes everything. Your spine, which in humans is swiveled back vertically, with the body weight supported entirely on the two legs, is now carried horizontally like a bridge by your forelegs. Your arms are now your front legs, and your back legs are much shorter than the long human legs. Unlike the hoofed animals, your five digits, in humans, the fingers, are still separate, although the dew claw of the front paw is very small. You only have four toes on the back legs because the fifth toe is so vestigial that it has no claw and is usually invisible. Your body weight is borne by the four toes of the 4 feet. Other animals may have more stamina in their forelimbs, but your forelimbs are designed for bursts of speed and quick acceleration. Your paws, with their specialized retractable claws, are mobile enough to grasp prey, to swat opponents, to climb trees, and to act as a comb in grooming. Your body is steadier and more stable than a human body. A cat never has to balance on one leg, for example. In order to imagine the world of an animal with four legs, humans can get down on their hands and knees, but it is not the same as having four legs for walking. One of the advantages of having four legs is that if you lose a leg in a car accident, you can learn to manage fine on three legs. Cats do not need crutches or false legs. Tanny, a feisty black and white kitten, was found in a farmyard, hidden away, waiting to die from a smashed front leg. The finder took her to the local vet. Within hours of the operation to remove the damaged leg, she was able to totter round the vet's surgery. Within days of being fostered by her new owner, Celia, she could jump and play like any normal kitten. After a few weeks with her new owners, they photographed her high up in a tree. She had climbed up easily on her three remaining legs, another advantage of having four legs to begin with. Cat agility. So as a cat, you will run faster, accelerate more quickly, jump higher, turn and twist more easily and balance better because of your four legs and flexible spine. You can jump very high from a standing start. You can leap high into the air to clear the top of long grass and complete an airborne front foot pounce to pin down your prey. You can walk, trot or canter, and also slowly crawl in a crouching posture low to the ground. These abilities are necessary for a hunter stalking its prey or slipping away from a predator in the undergrowth. The slow crouching retreat of a cat is sometimes nicknamed moonwalking. What you lose with the lowered body position is the ability to trot steadily for very long distances, like dogs or wolves that need to track and chase down their prey often for a long time. Your feline stealthy stalk takes extra energy because your legs cannot be efficiently swung like a pendulum. The major disadvantage of four legs is that you do not have the front legs free to use as hands. True, you can pounce on prey using the front paws to pin down a mouse. You can swipe with a single paw, leaving all the other three legs on the ground. You can poke with a front paw. You can, if you have an owner who teaches tricks, sit back on your bottom and wave both front legs in a kind of high five. You can even stand up on your two hind legs to get a higher field of vision, to look over high foliage, for instance. But you can only hold this position for a relatively short time. Your human fingers are now the toes of your front paws. You walk on the four toes of each foot instead of both toes and heels being flat on the ground like a human. The human stance is plantigrade. Yours is digitigrade, that is, you are standing on your digits, your toes. If a cat starts walking in a flat-footed way on the centre or back of their paws, not on the toes, it is often a sign of diabetic neuropathy or a ruptured tendon. Above your feline toes in the front leg are the metacarpal bones, which stretch upwards from the paw pads. In humans, these bones are flat, in the palm of the hand. The central pad of your paw is known as the metacarpal pad. Your feline wrist joint comes next and is relatively higher up towards the trunk of the body than in a human and marked by the carpal or stopper pad, so called because it can help you suddenly stop or reduce sliding when going down a slope. Your elbow is where the front leg appears to join the body. In your back legs, the ankle is where the leg hinges backwards and the knee is level with where the back leg joins the body. Forelegs and hind legs have a different structure and a different function. About 60% of your weight, according to one estimate, is carried by your front legs, while your back legs, which are longer, propel your body forwards, upwards, and over objects. Walking on tiptoes has advantages. Your paw pads are made up of elastic and collagen fibres with fatty tissue acting as a kind of shock-absorbing cushion when you jump down from a height. These hairless, cushioned pads with hair and glands in between them also help to keep your tiptoe walk silent, which is particularly useful for stalking prey. You walk lightly over the world, far more silently than humans can, partly because of this tiptoe anatomy, and partly because you are so much lighter. Like other but not all four-footed animals, your feline gait proceeds diagonally. In an ordinary walk with most of your weight towards the front of your body, if the right front leg moves forward, the next leg to move is the left back leg. Each leg is placed on the ground at a regular but slightly different time in a so-called four-beat gait. Your hind foot is placed almost onto the front paw print, and most of the time, three legs are on the ground. When you move fast, these diagonal leg movements are speeded up so that at moments only one or two legs may be on the ground, or even all four legs momentarily in the air, in a two-beat fast gait canter or gallop. In a canter or a gallop, your hind legs provide most of the force to speed forward in a leaping motion with the spine fully extended. Then, with all 4 feet off the ground, then compressed to bring your hindquarters under your body, your back legs touch the ground before pushing upwards again. All this sounds complicated when it's written down, but will feel as natural to the feline you as walking or running on two legs feels to a human who has good balance. You do not have to look down to what your feet are doing as you move, for you have scanned the ground a little further forward than your front feet to see if there are any obstacles. And unlike humans, you can lower your body to stalk without having to crouch down and curve your spine. Your feline paws are beautifully designed too. The four digits of each fore and back paw are thicker than ordinary skin, as is the skin on human feet. But your pads are far more sensitive than the soles of human feet. One reason for this sensitivity is that the skin folds between your pads, where the hair grows, are dense with nerve endings called touch domes, specialized areas full of cells that detect the exact nature of the ground you are walking upon. Cat toe pads are often affectionately nicknamed toe beans because their cushioned surface is a little like a jelly bean. Your feline fifth digit, the dew claw on the front paw, is higher up the front leg, like a kind of tiny thumb. It's not as useful as a human thumb, thus the joke that if cats had thumbs, they would rule the world. Your dew claw does help, however, in climbing. It steadies the leg when it's in contact with the tree trunk. It can also help you hold down struggling rodents or flapping birds. In some dogs, the dew claw steadies the foot when cantering. The dew claw does not help a cantering cat, however. It is the carpal stopper pad higher up than the dew claw on the inside of your wrist that can help you slow down when you have been moving at speed. Usually cats have 5 toes on each front foot and 4 toes on each back foot. Occasionally cats are born with more than the usual 18 toes. If you have 6 toes on your front paws, they will make your front feet splay out when you walk. Some of the extra toes may be slimmer than a normal toe, and not all of them will have a claw in each toe, though they may still play havoc scratching the sofa. The record for toes on a single feline paw is 9, though some of these may be stumps without claws. Polydactyl cats, the word comes from the Greek for many and finger, were prized as ship's cats. They were thought to be better mousers and also more able to steady themselves on a rocking ship with their splayed-out paws. When Daniel was in veterinary practice in Plymouth, one of Britain's important port cities, he saw a lot of polydactyl cats, possibly the modern descendants of these long-ago ship's cats, that were specially chosen by the Plymouth sailors for this useful trait. Your claws, pitons, and weapons. You have curved claws instead of flat nails. Human nails are static, cannot be moved, and grow out of skin. Your claws grow out of the bone, which is why declawed cats lose the tip of their toes, not just the claw. You can protract your claws so that you can use them to hold onto surfaces, but at rest your claws are sheathed. They are retracted and sheathed too when you're walking or running, unlike a dog's, so they stay sharp, unlike the blunt, thicker canine claw. You cannot do as much with a paw as humans can with a hand, but you can do quite a lot. Paws with claws protracted can be used to pull items towards you and to scratch in either defense or attack. Thanks to your curved claws, you can climb up a 90-degree angle tree trunk by digging them into the bark. Only a completely smooth 90-degree angle would defeat you because of the lack of grip available. Some humans can climb trees using their hands and feet on the branches, but most find it difficult, if not impossible, to climb up a right-angle trunk without a branch to hold onto. yet any healthy cat can shin up a tree in a trice. Humans use pitons, metal spikes driven into rock cracks by climbers. Your claws are your pitons. You can also weaponize your claws. Some cats pat their human's face affectionately with sheathed claws so that only the soft paw pad delicately touches the skin. But if they want a human or another cat to back off, they can do a swipe with the claws out. Those scratches are painful because the claws are so sharp. Human nails are inferior weapons for scratching because they are neither as sharp nor as strong as a feline claw. Human nails just grow continuously, and if by accident a human loses a nail, the exposed area underneath is painfully sensitive until the new nail grows from the base. You have a new claw ready for action. When your old claw falls off, the new one is revealed underneath. This is one of several reasons why you scratch the furniture or a scratch post, to pull off the worn-out sheath of the claw to uncover the new one. Claw accidents can occur in cats, of course, when the toenails or dew claws are torn off prematurely. These are just as painful for cats as for humans, as there is a high nerve and blood supply to the base of the claw. Jumps and wriggles. Human legs are great for walking and running, but not much use for jumping compared with your feline legs. The powerful muscles in your back legs mean that you can jump about 6 times or more your own height from a standing start. This feline takeoff speed is impressive and explains how you're able to pounce up and over tall grass onto a small mouse hidden from sight. What are the mechanics of this high pounce? The jump starts with a deep crouch. Maybe you shift your weight a little from leg to leg. Then your forelegs move upwards and your hind legs explode into movement. At liftoff, the hip and knee are at a tight angle, and to get the speed you need, they extend and straighten. No human being could jump anything like 6 times his or her own height from a standing start. You can also wriggle very low in a stalking posture, although it takes up quite a lot of energy. You can squeeze under the living room furniture even when there's only a tiny gap. A 4-inch space is enough for the average-sized cat, and many cats can wiggle into a gap lower than this if they're motivated either by fear or by the hope of catching a mouse there. Your flexibility is amazing. The bones of your spine are only loosely connected with each other and are well cushioned, allowing them to bend freely, and you have more vertebrae than a human spine has. Most adult humans have only 24 flexing vertebrae because the bottom vertebrae have fused together. Your feline spine has 27 flexing vertebrae, and you have a varying number in your tail depending on its length. The extraordinary way in which you double up your body to groom between your thighs is just one example of your flexibility. Your feline spine is so flexible, you can arch your back into a tight U-shape. There is also another reason why you can squeeze your body into tight places. You do not have a fixed collarbone as humans do. The human collarbone is attached to the shoulders on either side, bracing the arms into place either side of the chest. Your collarbone, or clavicle, is rudimentary, sometimes even absent, and is attached to the rest of the body by muscle, not ligament. This allows for a narrow chest and more flexibility. You can squeeze through narrow spaces in a way you could never do if a fixed collarbone was keeping your front shoulders apart. Telling tales. And of course, if you are a cat, you have a tail. All we humans have is the invisible stump of a tail, 3 to 5 vertebrae fused together and folded inwards into the coccyx to help us sit. Feline tail length varies from no tail at all and no tail vertebrae in a Manx cat through about 7 vertebrae in a Manx stumpy with a short tail to a normal cat's tail with 18 to 23 vertebrae, depending on length. It may be a wonderful bushy tail with long wavy hair on it like a Maine Coon, or it may be a tail with short hair in a short-haired domestic moggy. As a cat, you can feel the world with your tail just as you can feel the world with the rest of your body. Moreover, your tail is very mobile. The feline tail does not just hang limply. Special tendons and 6 pairs of muscles allow it to lift up, stiffen, move side to side, bend upwards and downwards, or draw down tight between the hind legs. The tip of your tail can move in a different direction to the rest of it. Your expressive tail can quiver, flick, thrash widely side to side, stick up straight from its base, often with a little forward curve at the tip, or lift up and then curve down about a third of its length. It acts as a signal for communication and a counterweight for any sudden movement of the body, thereby helping you to balance. Before modern ethical standards were introduced, researchers studied cats and their tails as the felines walked along a narrow beam that moved sideways. Cats with their tails intact used the tail by moving it in the opposite direction to the beam, allowing their body to stay on the beam. The researchers then cut the nerves to the tail so that the cat lost control of its movements and was more likely to fall off the beam completely. Yes, your tail helps with balance, but it is not necessary for balance in all circumstances.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.